Hi guys, today I want to continue my discussion on morphic resonance, the shared, collective, global consciousness field proposed by the esteemed British biologist Rupert Sheldrake. Morphic fields might be the reason behind mind synchronization, telepathy, and other baffling phenomena. Such fields have the intriguing characteristics of being able to collect memory and information through time and long distance. For example, experiments show later generations of lab rats escape their mazes more quickly than their forebears. As time went on, rats in laboratories all over the world escaped more and more quickly. The knowledge and skill of maze escaping somehow spread to future generations of lab rats in various countries which had absolutely no contact. Isn't that remarkable? Did the earlier maze rats upload the information they gathered to a cloud and shared it with other rats far away? How did the rats communicate remotely? On a related matter, in recent years, scientists have made eye-opening discoveries on how our brains function. Believe it or not, the sci-fi idea of direct brain-to-brain communication is actually reality. Multiple studies have reported direct transmission of brain activity among humans, animals, and even between species. This special communication is through the electric signals known as brainwaves generated by our brains. Brainwaves can be detected outside the skull, which means the electric signals can propagate beyond the brain and to the outside world. If two free-traveling brainwaves are in sync, could that create direct communication through mind? We have seen the amazing connections between some legendary horse whisperers and horses. Were they communicating via thoughts, aka brainwaves? Can someone else's brainwaves invoke ideas and emotions subconsciously for other humans and animals? Furthermore, since brainwaves can travel out of the scalp, does that mean these waves can mingle and accumulate in the air and eventually form certain informational fields? Are the weak brainwaves able to do so? Can such fields be related to the Akashic records? Edgar Cayce and Rudolf Steiner believed these records contained the recorded history of every thought, action, and deed of every life form beyond time and space. The so-called heartbeat of the Earth, the natural electromagnetic resonances, the Schumann resonances, are within the brainwave frequency range. Is there anything we can learn from the Schumann resonances that might illuminate the potential of brainwaves? There is so much to talk about. Let's get started. Human consciousness is still a big mystery. The good thing is, now we know that mind and brain are not separate entities. Most scientists today agree that consciousness is generated by the brain itself. The mind comes from the brain and nothing but the brain. Human brains are made of billions of neurons. When they fire, sending information to nearby neurons, they give off electric signals. The living brain generates its own weak electric field and produces a continuous output of small electric signals, the brainwaves, which can be measured by electroencephalography, EEG. Brainwaves are low energy and low frequency waves, which belong to the radio wave category on the electromagnetic spectrum. There are five widely recognized brainwaves, which are divided into bandwaves. The higher the frequency of the signal, the more work the brain is doing, and the greater the intensity of the brain activity. Electricity and magnetism are two sides of the same coin. Electromagnetism. This modern world we live in is powered by electromagnetic energy. Without such technology, cell phones, computers, TVs, GPS systems, and much more as we know it wouldn't function, let alone exist. Television and radio stations use radio waves to broadcast data through the air. Cell phones use high-frequency radio waves, microwaves, to send and receive signals. In a similar manner, our brains generate electromagnetic fields like radio stations and emit radio waves. The major difference is, compared to the high frequency and high energy waves, such as Wi-Fi signals, Brainwaves are dramatically weaker. Most of our brainwaves are extremely low frequency, ELF radio waves of 3 to 30 Hz. ELF waves have exceedingly long wavelengths of 100,000 to 10,000 kilometers. As a reference, the Earth's circumference is about 40,000 kilometers. This means some of our brainwaves' wavelength are even longer than the Earth's circumference. Pretty incredible, right? With those particularly long wavelengths, there come several correlative features. One of them is ELF waves have extremely low attenuation of 1 to 2 decibels per 1,000 kilometers, or 620 miles. Attenuation is the loss of signal strength. In other words, extremely low frequency ELF waves, including brain waves, lose almost no energy during propagation, which makes them suited for global communication. A single ELF transmitter has the ability to communicate worldwide. In contrast, high-frequency waves attenuate and weaken much more. The typical coverage radius of a cell tower in dense urban environments is only a quarter to a mile, or 400 to 1,000 meters. While ELF waves can circulate around the Earth several times before decaying to a negligible amplitude. This indicates the weak brainwaves of humans and animals can potentially travel very far since they have minimal energy losses. Looking at the EM spectrum, some might have the impression that high-frequency, high-energy waves like gamma rays move faster than radio waves. But actually, all the EM waves, brainwaves included, travel at the same speed in a vacuum, the speed of light, no matter what their frequencies are. Their speed reduces when going through mediums such as atmosphere and water. The denser the medium, the slower they get. For instance, metal can block cell phone signals. Barriers of lead, concrete, or water can shield gamma rays, the highest frequency waves, but they cannot stop ELF waves. Brainwaves are the opposite of gamma rays. They are mostly extremely low frequency waves. On the aspect of penetrating dense materials, low frequency waves have great advantage. ELF waves can penetrate solid materials and hundreds of meters of seawater without too much decay, which is why they're used to communicate with submarines at their normal operating depth, deep under the ocean. A short coded message could be transmitted through ELF waves to submarines almost anywhere in the world. From the origin of an electromagnetic wave, the wave will propagate outwards in all directions. If the medium in which it's propagating, air, for example, is the same everywhere, the wave will spread out uniformly in all directions. Since brainwaves can be detected outside the skull, that suggests from there these waves can start traveling everywhere in the air. Because most human and animal brainwaves belong to the extremely low frequency band, they lose minimal energy during propagation, so they don't die out easily. The truth is, it's very difficult to get rid of ELF waves. Considering how fragile biological lives can be, it's conceivable that brainwaves could even live on longer than the person who created them. Since ELF waves can penetrate solid materials much better than any other electromagnetic waves, such waves, including brainwaves, are not easily confined or blocked. For these reasons, we can assume that extremely low-frequency brainwaves can exist for extended periods of time and reach to distant places. But no matter how little energy it takes for brainwaves to broadcast, they still need enough wattage to begin with. Do brainwaves have enough amplitude to travel? What's the energy threshold for brainwaves to go far enough to mingle and interact with other brainwaves? To answer this, we might find clues from the global electromagnetic resonances, known as the Schumann resonances. Schumann resonances are generated by lightning and natural disturbance in Earth's magnetic field, and they encircle our planet. These electromagnetic waves occur because the space between the surface of the Earth and the conductive ionosphere acts as a closed waveguide or resonator. Schumann resonances range from 3 Hz through 60 Hz and appear as distinct peaks at extremely low frequencies, around 7.8, 14, 21 Hz, etc., which means they share similar frequencies with brainwaves. Also like brainwaves, Schumann resonances are very weak signals. Its electric field amplitude is about 300 microwatts per meter. The higher the amplitude, the stronger the signal. Multiple research articles state the sensors that measure Schumann resonances produce amplitudes of a few microwatts. Now, how about our brainwaves? Are they weaker or stronger? Brain frequencies are very complex, and they are almost always mixtures of frequencies overlaying one another. Brainwaves have varying frequencies and amplitudes corresponding to the arousal of the cerebral cortex. In general, the amplitude of the EEG increases as the frequency decreases. Beta waves are high-frequency brainwaves that are commonly observed while we are awake, and they usually have an amplitude of less than 30 microwatts. Alpha waves range from 30 to 70 microwatts. Delta waves have the highest amplitudes, which is up to 200 microwatts. Another paper reports the amplitude of the EEG is about 100 microwatts when measured on a scalp. In comparison, Schumann resonances do not exceed several microwatts. That's much lower than the amplitudes of our brainwaves. These numbers indicate that the brainwaves could have higher energy than Schumann resonances, which might result in them traveling further than Schumann resonance waves. Let's go back to the fact that although the energy level of Schumann resonances is truly tiny, they can circle the globe. How can that happen? Here's NASA's explanation. At any given moment, about 2,000 thunderstorms roll over Earth, producing some 50 flashes of lightning every second. Each lightning burst creates electromagnetic waves that begin to circle around Earth. Some of the waves, if they have just the right wavelength, combine, increasing in strength, to create a repeating atmospheric heartbeat, known as Schumann resonances. So, even though these waves are super weak, because they are mostly trapped within the ionosphere, strength in number, they accumulated and resonated at the right frequencies, which in turn increased their amplitude to a level where they can encircle the planet. The same collective strengthening effect could also work for the extremely low-frequency brainwaves. Since brainwaves have higher energy than Schumann resonances, they have the potential to intermix in the atmosphere. Brainwaves are not consistent, and their frequencies keep changing. Waves can also cancel each other out. It might be extraordinarily difficult for such complex, varying waves to combine or resonate. However, humans and animals are all brainwave generators, no matter sleeping or awake, and there are so many of us. Humans alone are over 7.8 billion. Strength in numbers, right? Just think about the magnitude and abundance of all the brainwaves out there. Most of the brainwaves might largely consist of fragmented, cluttered, and incoherent noise-like data that diminishes as time goes on. But there ought to be enough of them that share the same frequencies, whereby they can combine, increasing in strength, like Schumann resonances, and create a collective electromagnetic field. This field possesses a tremendous amount of data, such as thoughts and emotions coming from the radio waves broadcast by brains. Remember the experiments where students were asked to interact with unknown foreign phrases? Somehow, people in mysterious ways can pick out a more popular foreign word in a lineup without ever seeing or knowing the word. We can try to explain this now. Each time a phrase is spoken or thought of, it could literally generate a unique brainwave. The more times it's talked about or thought of, the more brainwaves are generated in the same frequency. These brainwaves can combine and resonate to the extent that they can even propagate around the world. Since a well-known rhyme is used by millions of people, it could have a stronger signal, and the signal is more likely to be picked up by a person even though he or she is far away and speaks a different language. In a way, This implies that strong enough combined brainwaves can subconsciously influence the individuals, and this process could further strengthen the wave's amplitude, therefore further improving their informational influence. This could be the reason that the later lab rats are getting better at escaping their mazes than their forebears. It's sensible to postulate that the brainwaves of earlier rats, which contain maze-escaping skills, combined and resonated to a stronger signal that can be perceived by later rats around the planet. This new knowledge and memory got conveyed to future generations,
like an inheritance.
If this is the case, then it most definitely happened to humans too. So, we can't overlook the possibility that there could be ancient, extremely low-frequency brainwaves still traveling through the globe and touching us at this moment. As we discussed earlier, across the EM spectrum, ELF waves have the best longevity on Earth and are the most difficult waves to eliminate. Therefore, it's not unthinkable that a small portion of some dominated thoughts or information from the ancient, prehistoric era survived in the form of brainwaves. These informational waves got preserved because they resonated with brainwaves of later generations, thus they became reinforced. These ancient signals might get strong enough to cast a long-lasting, hereditary-like effect, which have influenced thoughts and decision-making throughout history. They can also weaken and disappear. Every generation, everyone is contributing to this brainwave field. At the same time, this field might be affecting everyone subconsciously. Okay, let me summarize. Human and animal consciousness, thoughts, and emotions come from the brains. Brains produce continuous small electromagnetic signals known as brainwaves. Brainwaves are extremely low-frequency waves, which hold vast information and can propagate beyond the skull. Another group of extremely low-frequency waves are Schumann resonances, which share similar frequencies with the brainwaves. Schumann resonances have even weaker signals than brainwaves, though through combining and resonating, they strengthen, thereby they can encircle the entire planet. Consequently, the accumulation of global-wide human and animal brainwaves might be able to create a similar collective wave field and resonance. Living beings can sometimes tune into this massive, fuzzy, and dim informational field, which subtly invokes ideas and emotions. I hypothesize this collective informational brainwave field might be the morphic field as proposed by Dr. Sheldrake. Since the Akashic records were considered a record covering all entities and life forms, not just human, and were described as a compendium of all the events, thoughts, words, emotions, and intentions throughout time, this concept seems to be related to the brainwave field. However, I still have a lot of unanswered questions about this possible electromagnetic field, such as, can the Schumann resonances affect our brainwave field? If so, then in which way? Since Schumann resonances share similar frequencies with brainwaves, could these two combine into one? What if the Schumann resonances actually are the morphic resonance or brainwave field? Can we extract information out of the brainwave resonances, similar to how radio receivers convert the information to a readable form? Researchers have discovered that checking brainwaves can decode a person's mood. Brainwaves also relate to social behavior. So, by reading and interpreting the brainwave field, can we figure out the collective human mood or overall personality?
If this is possible, then what does it say about us, and how does it define us as a species? Are we in general good, ambivalent, or bad? Say extraterrestrials were visiting Earth. Could it test our brainwave field first to check the mentality of the locals in order to decide whether to make contact or not? Our brainwave field is both modern and ancient, both ephemeral and perpetual, both volatile and consistent. This collective residual memory field might even contain recorded information from prehistoric and ancient human civilizations. Meanwhile, we are contributing to this field now as we live, think, act, and speak. What kind of a legacy do we want to leave for future generations? If you like my video, please subscribe to my channel and share with others. You can also support me on Patreon, which is a monthly charge, kind of like you buying me a cup of coffee once a month. I appreciate your support. This is Curious Being. I'm Tina. Thanks for watching and see you next time.